Our next speaker is Iain Murray. Now, it has been my great fortune to be able to collaborate with Iain and David on a couple of papers on Bayesian modeling and inference. And this was tremendously fun, but for me personally, it really represented a kind of a phase change in my scientific career where the experience of the collaboration with these two took me from feeling like I sort of really didn't know anything at all about anything to feeling like maybe it was possible for me to be able to do some science. It was an incredibly sort of life-changing experience. Today, Iain is going to tell us, I think, about some clever stuff that he's been doing with Markov chain Monte Carlo. I know Iain very well, and as soon as I sit down, he's going to insist that it's actually not clever, but don't be fooled. Iain Murray.
Thanks very much. It's such a pleasure to be here. I thought I'd first start out just with some comments about my introduction to machine learning and statistics from David. So I was an undergrad physicist here in Cambridge, and I'm not being modest when I say I was not near the very top of the year. I know someone who was, Paul McFadden, who did his final year project with David, was an amazing physicist, and you heard yesterday that he was doing quantum error correcting codes. David proposed a pretty eclectic set of final year projects. So another one he proposed, which I didn't do, was, why do you seem heavier if you stand on bathroom scales on a carpet instead of on a hard floor? And I was like, is that true? And I called my parents, and they were like, yeah, it's totally true. We have our scales on a piece of wood. And I was like, well, why is it? And they were like, we don't know. So, you know, I had to find out. So this is a photo from 2001 where I had some email exchange with David. So I borrowed a fire extinguisher because I was worried maybe it had something to do with people tottering around on the carpet. And this is a fire extinguisher that weighs 2 pounds more if it's propped up on a CD case that I put the scale on, as opposed to it being on firm ground. So it turns out that there are little feet on scales here that it's designed to sit on, and the mechanical scales are designed to flex in a certain way when you stand on them. And if you have them on a carpet, or if you put it on some device that it's not designed to sit on, then that flexing doesn't happen in the normal way. So David had a student who took some scales apart and really got to the bottom of it, because, you know, you don't want to do things by halves like I did. You should actually take the damn scales apart, which I refused to do, and instead did a project on language modeling with David. So I don't think anyone else in the physics department can have come close to supervising three projects so different in a single year. I think probably the first time I met David was when we asked him to come and talk at our science society in my college, and he came to dinner with us, and as people have said, you know, of course the napkin came out and he had to explain something to me. I think it's probably about combinatorics. I didn't believe it was hard to solve combinatorial optimization problems, and you explained to me why that was an interesting thing to work on. So I went to Gatsby to do my PhD, and as we've heard from several people, I was amazingly lucky that David came there once a week. Sometimes I wasn't sure if I was lucky, because it was a bit like a denial of service attack against whatever it was I was supposed to be doing, because every week he'd come with some cool, fun puzzle or something interesting to think about, and, you know, of course, that's what the whole PhD experience is about, and that's what I remember. So I'm incredibly grateful for that. David also gave a whole series of talks when he visited Gatsby, and some of them have been mentioned already, that, you know, the embryonic talk where he first thought about energy, and I remember sitting over lunch and talking about his thoughts of energy before that, and being very impressed that your views on some things changed. So I won't say what your early views were, but I know that some things you changed your mind on, which impressed me. Another talk that sticks in my head was a talk entitled Two Mistakes in My Book. So it does turn out that David makes mistakes, and you know, he really wants to get to the bottom of really going in and understanding how things should be done. So what I want to do in this talk is do the same sort of thing. That way of thinking has inspired me. And there's an old problem that I worked on in my PhD where I've gone back and realized that I made it way too complicated. It's actually really easy. And so, as Ryan predicted, the whole point of this talk is I want you to go away thinking I haven't done anything clever. And if you think it's complicated, then I failed. So I'll do my best. So it's going to be a technical mathy thing involving Markov chain Monte Carlo, and I know there's sort of quite a broad set of people here. So first, let me sort of set the scene. What sort of problem are we going to solve? So as John just nicely explained, like you should write down regression is a nice picture that you can talk about. So if we have this data set, you could imagine where might that data have come from. And one of the things that we're told to do as undergrad physics students is like slap down a ruler and draw lines that might go through the data you've plotted in your lab book. So you could plot lines that you think might explain that data as plausible explanations. If you're a machine learning person, you might want to sort of, and you might not be interested in what the line is, you're interested in doing prediction. So you could say each of those lines, if I knew one was true, I could go somewhere else, extrapolate. They'd each make different predictions, and I could average those predictions as a way of sort of making good guesses into the future. So this talk is about going to be drawing the purple lines. How is it that you, given a model of data, have plausible explanations of where that data might have come from? So the model is going to have parameters theta, and here a purple line is a setting of theta. So there's a slope and an intercept, two numbers, that's theta. So let me give you another example. This is a simulated toy problem that was part of a competition I entered a couple of years ago. I did reasonably well. I didn't win, but the person who won did basically the same thing as me. I came second. So the Bayesian solution was the right way to go about this. And the cosmological problem was to do with weak lensing. So there are galaxies, and they have orientations or ellipticities. And very massive objects we can't see bend light and change the apparent orientation of the galaxies. So in this simulated example, the effect is incredibly strong. And you can see a region where the orientations of the galaxies suspiciously form a ring. And so you could fit a model saying, where do I believe the dark matter is explaining this image? And in the simulation, it was there, which might not surprise you. But if you look at patches of real sky, often it's not so clear. So you could look at those orientations of galaxies and go, can I spot any dark matter in this picture? And it's not so clear. So maybe there are three concentrations of dark matter in those positions, and they're just not very massive, so the lensing effect isn't so strong. And you'd find it pretty hard to prove that there aren't, but you know, there isn't strong evidence. So maybe there are three dark matter halos in those positions, or in those positions. Who knows? So what we want to do is explore all the possible settings of what might underlie the image. And from this one image, we won't be able to tell very much. But if you combine millions of patches of sky, you can begin to infer interesting physics about dark matter. So we'll have a model with parameters theta. And instead of theta being a slope and an intercept, we might have like 15 or so numbers. There's six numbers saying where the positions of those crosses are. There'll be more numbers saying what the masses of the dark matter halos are and the shapes of them and things like that. And what we're wanting is computer code that will say, here are plausible explanations. Maybe the masses are all quite low. If you superimpose all the explanations that the computer code explores, those are the red dots. And the dark red dots are more massive dark matter halos, and the light red dots are sort of weedy ones that don't do very much. So although it's hard for us to see by eye, the computer is fairly sure that there's a good chance of there being dark matter around here. There may well be two halos. In the simulation, the truth was the three black crosses. So the simulation had a dark matter halo here, but it was not very massive and not really detectable, and there could have been dark matter halos in almost any other location of weedy mass too. So if you want to summarize what you know, samples are a convenient way of doing it, because when things are so uncertain and diffuse, there's no simple way of summarizing dark matter locations. It's like a point in an error bar. A bag of samples is a useful way to go. And using a bag of samples, you could win this prediction competition. Okay, so for These and many other problems, but not all problems, this method called Markov chain Monte Carlo is the way to go. And given a model with parameters, it says, what are the plausible parameters given data? And there are these algorithms described very nicely in David's book that tell you how to draw these pictures, how to say, here are possible explanations of your data set. This equation of this distribution comes from Bayes' rule, and all we need to know is it's some positive function of the parameters we know how to evaluate. So we have a positive function that says, here is the goodness of the parameters. How compatible is it with the data set? Does this look like a plausible setting of the parameters? OK. I'm trying to look for the non-statisticians to see if you're with me. Great. So here is the simplest such algorithm that can explore parameters. It's one of the earliest uses of computers. So in the Metropolis et al. Paper was published in the 50s. And these algorithms were developed in the Manhattan Project. So a very significant part of computer science. In this picture, we're exploring theta space. So you could imagine I start off initializing a slope and an intercept of a line and a line fit. And then I wiggle the slope and intercept around. So as I follow this trajectory, the line that I'm fitting will be wandering around through the data. And what this algorithm does is it takes your current setting of your model parameters, a slope and an intercept, or 15 numbers describing a configuration of dark matter, and it perturbs it. So it says, oh, maybe you want to wander off to this setting in model space, or that setting. And when you wander off somewhere bad, the algorithm rejects that. It says, no, stay where you are. And when you make good proposals, you wander around a model space, occasionally being kicked back in so that you end up exploring a ball of plausible models. Right. So. A lot of you will know this and love it and have implemented it. For those who haven't seen it, the one thing you need to know is that the only thing the algorithm needs to do is evaluate this function f. It needs to say, what's the goodness of the parameters you're considering wandering to compared to the parameters that you're currently at? So you're taking this walk around in model space. I've currently got this configuration of dark matter. Should I swap over to this new configuration of dark matter, or should I stay where I am? And to make that decision, to stay put or to move, you have to evaluate this function. OK. What happens if you can't evaluate that function? That would be annoying. And there's some quite technical papers in the statistics literature on the so-called pseudo-marginal MCMC methods, where they say, there are situations where you can't evaluate this function describing the goodness exactly, but you can still make progress. And what they rely on is you having what's called an unbiased estimator, f hat. So you have some noisy computer code. It uses a random number generator somewhere. And instead of evaluating f of theta that says how good are your parameters, it gives you a noisy result, which is sometimes too big and sometimes too small. And on average, it's correct. Okay, so if it's possible to have such a thing, there's this literature that says there are a bunch of algorithms you could use. So I will give you an example of a situation in which this is the case. And this is a puzzle that Zubin gave me. It was the first puzzle I was given in my PhD, and I've realized that to solve problems, in fact, you have a string of puzzles that go together that you have to solve. So the puzzle Zubin gave me was, what if you have a model which is an undirected graphical model, which is jargon, or an unnormalized model, where it's hard to evaluate the probability of the data you've observed given a setting of the model parameters. So you have a model which is specified in terms of a positive function g, and that function says, what sort of data do I want my model to like? So an example of this is you have a model describing binary images. So here I've got 16 binary variables. You could have a model with a function g that says, I don't like noisy images. I want to see smooth images with large regions of black and large regions of white. And that's not a sort of generative description of how to paint pixels. It's just saying what you want. And then you define your model by saying, I'm going to renormalize things by dividing by this normalizing constant to define a probabilistic model of how I think images should be generated. And there are lots of models that have this form. Rather than a concrete procedure to generate data like a probabilistic program, you have soft constraints. Protein folding could be like that, a physical system where it says, well, you just relax to some energy configuration. And there are a bunch of these models where you can't evaluate the probability of the data given the parameters because you can't work out this quantity exactly, this normalizing constant. And here's why Z's important. This is a cartoon picture. And in this cartoon, this axis is the space of data sets. So I've got four little blue dashes here, which are my observed data. So I've got four images. And what I want to do is find a model that explains the data I've seen. So there are two parts of the model. There's this function G, which is a green curve. And I want to say there's high goodness around the data I've observed and low goodness in other places. That's a good model that explains this is the sort of data you get. And what a Markov chain Monte Carlo procedure might do is say, here is another setting of the parameters that gives a different curve, and it gives higher goodness to the data that you've observed, but it's a promiscuous model that also gives high goodness to lots of other data sets. So it says, oh, I'm giving a large value to these images you've observed, but I'm also going to give high values to noisy junk. And that's not a good model. And so the penalty is this quantity Z. That is the area under this curve. And by creating this bubble in data space, normalizing the model penalizes that. Okay. So if we want to compare two models, we have to be able to normalize them and say, is this a good model for our data and not lots of other data that we didn't see? Okay. So technically, when you write down Bayes' rule, what I've just described is a doubly intractable problem. There's a constant that you can't evaluate that we normally can't evaluate, but the term that we want to evaluate for MCMC, this function f, contains a quantity we don't know how to compute exactly. And so to implement one step of these standard algorithms, these algorithms that explore our model fits, we'd need to do very large computations and computations we don't know how to do exactly. However, there is a large literature on how to get unbiased estimates of both Z and 1 over Z. So if we have a method that can approximate this normalizing constant that we don't know how to compute, then we could turn to the literature and we could say, well, how do we do MCMC? And we wrote some of those papers, and other people have as well. So some of the literature says all you need is an unbiased estimator. Here's what an unbiased estimator means. I've got a theta axis, those are my model parameters, and as a function of those parameters, there's some goodness function f I'd like to evaluate. This is the only figure that's worth understanding in the talk, by the way. If we could evaluate that blue function, we could run a normal Markov chain Monte Carlo. Instead, we've got an unbiased estimator f hat. And this is some computer code that depends not just on the model we're wanting to evaluate, theta, but also some arbitrary random numbers u that we generate from a random number generator. So if you have some computer code that gives out random answers, it's because it's calling a random number generator somewhere and getting numbers u. So this surface I'm plotting is the joint surface of what would the estimator give if I'm at some particular model parameters and I draw a particular random number from my random number generator. And in general, we might have hundreds of model parameters and hundreds of random numbers. And if the estimator is unbiased, which is this equation at the bottom, it means that if we collapse this surface, we collapse out the u's, we'll get the blue curve. So for theta equals minus 2, we sometimes underestimate if we draw a u equals 1, but we massively overestimate if we draw a u equals 0. And on average, as we look along a line like in this direction, we get the right answer. Okay? So that's just the definition of an unbiased estimator. Now, here is why it's obvious that actually it's easy to do Markov chain Monte Carlo in this situation. Imagine that blue surface is a piece of glass, and the theta u axis at the bottom was solid, and we put boundaries around the edges and filled it full of water. Okay. Now we put a swimmer underneath that glass surface and let them swim around at random. So I will swim up into this peak and down and then sort of underneath this ridge and back, and you swim around underneath that surface. What will happen? So you spend, if you swim around a lot for a long time, you'll spend the same amount of time in any particular cube in that volume. And you could ask the question, how long would I spend in this strip at theta equals 2? And how long would I spend in this strip at theta equals minus 2? And the amount of time you'd spend in any particular strip is just proportional to the volume in that underneath that piece of glass. And that's proportional to the height of this blue curve, which is proportional to the distribution we're wanting to sample from. So if we can wander around, if we can swim underneath the surface, we'll explore model parameters theta and settings of these random numbers u. And the amount of time we spend at each model, at each set of parameters, is the correct fraction of the time. So if only there was some textbook that contained some algorithms that said how to wander around uniformly in volumes under surfaces. Oh, there is one. So there are algorithms that say exactly how to do what I've just described. Okay, so that is the one picture. And for people who don't like pictures, there's an equation. I think there's probably two people that would prefer the equation. Here is what we're doing. There's a joint distribution over model parameters and these arbitrary random numbers u. And what we're going to do is run a standard MCMC method, either the one I showed you or any of the better ones that are in David's book, on this joint distribution I've written on the slide. So rather than drawing the random numbers from a random number generator, like the unbiased estimator told us what to do, we're going to set them ourselves by wiggling them. And if we explore these parameters theta and these random numbers u, and then we throw away the u's, what models will we explore? Marginally, the distribution over the models we'll explore is just given by probability theory. It's this integral. Ooh, integrals are hard, but the integral of that top line is just the average value of f hat under random numbers drawn from, I didn't tell you what q was, sorry. Q is whatever the distribution that your random code uses. So if you draw Gaussian random numbers, then Q is a Gaussian distribution. If your code uses uniform random numbers, then Q is uniform. So averaging over whatever your random estimator says you should draw random numbers under, what is f hat? And we declared that that should be the correct answer. So we're done. Here's what the popular algorithm in the literature is. We're exploring this joint target distribution. I've just copied the equation. And what the literature tells you to do is to perturb your model parameters in the way you normally would, and then make up these random numbers by just drawing them independently, ignoring the old setting. And the reason they tell you to do that is that the Metropolis acceptance rule looks exactly the same as normal. So it looks like you're running the standard algorithm, but you replace f with f hat, which is nice and interpretable. But it doesn't work very well. So in the standard algorithm, you're at some theta and u, so I'm at some point under this surface. And I might tweak my model. I'll change the slope and intercept of my fit a little bit. And then I'm going to draw new random numbers, so I'll just shoot along the u-axis some arbitrary distance. So if I'm in some tight peak and I draw a u without looking at the current value, I'm likely to just shoot off into the void and not get a new acceptable point. So this pseudo-marginal algorithm is notorious for what's called sticking. You get stuck in a peak under this surface, and then the swimmer, rather than moving around slowly, tries to teleport out to some place that doesn't exist. So what we've proposed is to just do more standard MCMC. We're going to update our model parameters and use separately rather than doing a bold move of both of them together. If we clamp the seed in our random number generator, that means that we just run standard MCMC on our model. So you can run hybrid Monte Carlo or slice sampling or whatever your favorite method is after reading your favorite textbook, and it looks just like standard MCMC. And then you do need to move these auxiliary variables U as well. So if you clamp your model, you need to update these variables from the same target distribution that I had on the previous slides. And if, say, you have Gaussian random numbers, and that's reweighted by some function, there are black box routines that will update these U's with no free parameters. So in fact, Ryan Adams, David, and I have a paper called elliptical slice sampling for precisely this problem. It will tell you how to move these random numbers around without you having to set anything. So I think I'm running quite slow, so I'm going to wrap up. I'm going to show you one figure. Here is a method that I implemented in my PhD work, and Zubin and David might remember that it was horrendously complicated. The estimator involved this elaborate sampling process called coupling from the past to construct the estimator, involved thousands of random numbers, and it works terribly. So if you look at how well the chain is coupled at time zero, how strongly correlated it is at time zero and time 2000, there's a strong correlation, meaning the Markov chain doesn't forget where you initialized it. It doesn't explore the model space very quickly. If you get that same code, and instead of doing all the clever stuff I did in my thesis that involved deriving loads of maths and doing stuff, you just replace the random number generator with something that does a load of slice sampling bookkeeping in the background, which you could do the same thing for any model, the autocorrelations crash down to zero really quickly. And so just having the right picture so that it's obvious, if you think about MCMC every day, it's obvious what to do, could have saved God knows how many months of work. So I'll wrap up there. I think lots of people have expressed really well how David's taught them to really get down to the bottom of issues. And I realize not everyone in the room will have followed what I just said, but hopefully you'll have got some sense for the sort of excitement I've got in learning how to look at little puzzles and try and really nail them. And that's something I've really enjoyed doing. Thank you very much, David.
We have time for a couple of questions.
Hi there, great talk. So in conventional pseudo-marginal MCMC, there's this idea that if you get a low variance estimator, then the pseudo-marginal MCMC will mix better.
Yep.
Is there any sort of kind of equivalent idea in what you're doing?
Yeah. Okay, so the question is that if my estimator was low variance, things work well. And this picture explains that. So if theta equals 2 here, this surface is roughly the same height for all u. So no matter what random number I draw, I get the same answer. So it's a low variance estimator. And if I'm at theta equals 2 and I draw an arbitrary u, and I was under the surface before, I'll stay under the surface. So all those moves will work, and it will be an acceptance rate of near 1. Whereas over here, where there's high variance, I get different answers for different random numbers, it doesn't work well. So you can see why a low variance estimator is good. These spikes cause problems. But if you're not really sure you can get rid of all those spikes, then it's safer to back off and do small steps rather than trying these brave moves where you set 100 U's independently at random.
I have a question. So one of the things that's surprising about pseudo-marginal MCMC is that the estimator can be negative, but that, of course, I mean, in principle could be negative and you could wind up with an unbiased estimator of this positive quantity. So in general, that seems to break pseudo-marginal Metropolis-Hastings. But here, I assume this also breaks, or is there any sort of interesting way to think about sort of negative estimators.
So Ryan's gently pointing out that I failed to state one of the caveats. So I said, oh, for any unbiased estimator, this sheet of glass can't go beneath the surface or my analogy breaks down and it doesn't work. So this estimator has to be positive. There is work on dealing with the so-called sign problem that you're talking about, but to be honest, I don't have anything to say about it.
Okay, one more question.
Okay, so about what you just said, there's a paper that by Pierre Jacob and other authors, and they talk about the impossibility to get unbiased and positive estimators. So, it's kind of interesting because it's not easy to get an unbiased estimator of 1 over the normalizing constant, which is positive at the same time. So, anyway. And so in the usual pseudo-marginal, we know that it targets the correct distribution. We know that it targets the right posterior distribution because when you compute the acceptance rate, something cancels out nicely and then it's easy to show. But how about in the slice sampling? Is it easy to show that it targets the right one?
So there was a long question there. The first part of the question was, sometimes it's not possible to come up with positive unbiased estimators, and that's true. And there are interesting situations where we'd really like to apply this technology and we don't know how. The last part of the question was, how can we show that we've got the correct stationary distribution? And I think that's the proof. But if you've got a follow-up question of why that's not enough, maybe catch me afterwards.
Let's thank Iain again.